the way that Google started was an academic venture.
How do you find interesting problems in the world?
Google depends on academia. So many of the good ideas that we've brought forward to the world come from academia.
One of the real reasons to engage with academia is to get a really fresh perspective.
We empower academics to work on real problems, and in the other direction, academics bring ideas and new approaches and are put into practice much more quickly than in an academic environment.
You know, oh, that's interesting, that's interesting, that's interesting. All of a sudden, you've knitted together something that is really, really tremendously powerful.
We need their help because of the problem we're trying to solve internally.
Academia can look far out into the future. It can take greater risks and look for really interesting solutions that industry sometimes cannot.
My name is Randy Sargent, and I'm at Carnegie Mellon University, where I work on making large sets of time series imagery and data explorable and understandable.
My name is Rebecca Moore. I'm on the Google Earth and Maps team. I'm an engineering manager there. I lead the development of Google Earth Engine, which is our high-performance computing platform for environmental data analysis. I first met Randy in 2005. I had just joined the Google Earth team as the tech lead for the Google Earth layers. There was an innovative idea that Brian McClendon had come up with to overlay thousands of aerial images that had been taken by a National Geographic explorer over Africa that were so high resolution, they were, I think, 1 inch per pixel. You know, if we could succeed in putting those in Google Earth, you would be able to zoom from outer space to see the eyelashes on a camel. Randy Sargent was the genius who figured out how to do that. So that's where I first met Randy.
That was a fun time. I was working at NASA Ames Research Center with a team of people at that time. And we worked with you not only on that, but also on other things, taking National Geographic stories and putting them in Google
right.
Earth.
So from the very beginning, going back almost 10 years, it was all about innovative use of imagery and making that accessible to billions of people who use, you know, Google Earth and Google Maps.
We were starting to work with scientists who wanted to use time series zoomable images. So building videos, if you will, where instead of every frame being, you know, 2 million pixels, like, you know, 1080p video, each frame might be a billion pixels or even more. And we had this technology, and there were just a few tiny applications of it, and we were looking for something really interesting to do with it. And this is about the time that I learn about Earth Engine, Rebecca's newest project, and we brainstormed about how could we connect these two.
We built Earth Engine to store an unprecedented amount of satellite data. U.S. taxpayers have funded missions like the Landsat satellite mission that have been continuously collecting millions of images of the planet going back to the Vietnam War era. The first project of our Google Earth Engine team was to work with the U.S. government to liberate, you know, those petapixels of data off those tapes and bring them online. We're now applying our highly parallel analysis and data mining techniques that we built a framework for in Earth Engine. We could start to produce derivative products. We'd been tracking what his project called Time Machine, which is this zoomable, panable, explorable time-varying imagery. And he had done one interesting thing that related to a certain satellite imagery data set called MODIS. And we saw that and we thought, well, what if we could connect his Time Machine methodology for this HTML5 video capability to the petapixels of data that we now had in Earth Engine.
You know, before coming to Google, the largest video we had ever produced was maybe a billion pixels per frame. And scaling by three orders of magnitude to trillions of pixels per frame to capture all of the historical Landsat, it really required new ways of thinking about architecting the software and interfacing to the large infrastructure here at Google.
What we did with Randy is build the world's first interactive, panable, zoomable animation of the Earth going back three decades. The Earth is changing dramatically over these decades in ways that are observable from space. You can see urban development, unbelievable urban development, not only in what we call the developing world, but even in the US. Las Vegas was the fastest growing city over that period. And you can watch in this animation as Las Vegas is growing and nearby Lake Mead is shrinking.
Watching the millions of people come to the site, watching the ways it's being used, I could not be happier.
In the first few days of the release, we had more than 3 million people around the world come and view it. Time magazine published a huge feature online and in print on what are the phenomena that you could see really and grasp for the first time in this time-lapse Earth.
Going back into the history of Landsat and looking at, you know, how the Earth looked from space, it's just the tip of the iceberg. If you look at what Earth Engine was truly built to do, it was built to also provide analysis on top of this historical imagery. You know, what can we quantify what's happening to the planet? What are the trends? And what, you know, the sort of information that comes from that, we need to also make that interesting, useful, explorable, usable by people in the policy community, usable by the general public. You know, we need to, you know, figure out, you know, what's happening to the Earth over time, but we also need to be able to communicate and understand that.
This first time lapse was of imagery, but now we could do time lapses of derived information. In other words, we're turning those pixels into knowledge, and now let's show the time lapses of that.
Being able to take ideas and then scale them to real and pressing problems. You know, scale them not only to huge, you know, sets of data like the entire planet in this case, but then take the results and bring those out, you know, to everyone on the planet. You know, something that we could not do at Carnegie Mellon.
Take something like the Landsat satellite catalog. It's a treasure trove of data that has never fired a single neuron in a single human brain. And this is sad. Well, now these projects like this time-lapse Earth are causing lots of neurons to fire and lots of human brains.
If you're interested to see more about the time-lapse Earth that we worked on together, please stay tuned for my talk.